الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته In the month of Ramadan, a very important event took place which changed the whole face of the earth, and its effect is still being felt today, and it will still be felt until the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah. And we are talking about on the 17th of Ramadan, the Battle of Badr. Its importance cannot be overemphasized. The primary cause of the Battle of Badr lay in the determination of Quraysh in trying to get rid of Islam. And they want to destroy the Muslim community simply because they believed in one Allah. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a messenger, and more so that it came from their community. And they could see, the Makkans or the Quraysh could foresee, that if this was allowed to continue, the Muslims in other words, they would pose a serious threat to the established position that they have, and the prestige of Quraysh would be damaged, and their God, which they believed in, would diminish in their eyes. So these tyrants not only confined themselves to verbal opposition to the Prophet ﷺ, but they also chastised those Muslims that followed his message. And it was further compounded by the personal boycotts that used to take place against the family members, against the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet alayhi salam was publicly ridiculed. Even things and intestines were thrown upon him. This was the type of punishment, if you can call it that, that took place, and hardships. And their message was what? To believe in Allah, to give them a good quality of life, take them out of ignorance into light. But the Quran, Allah did not command them yet to fight. Allah told them to be patient and bear the consequences of this destructiveness that Quraysh is imposing. Why? Because Islam was at a very early age, beginning stages. The Muslims, the new Muslims, were small in number. They could never go into an armed struggle at that time. It was impossible. Because they were numerically, and as far as their arms is concerned, they were hopelessly outnumbered. To such a degree, the persecution was so bad that the Muslims were forced to emigrate to Abyssinia, today as we know as Ethiopia, where they sought refuge by the king of Negus. That's why we as Muslims are duty bound to show a sense of loyalty to our brothers and sisters from Ethiopia when they come running here to us. We owe that type of allegiance. Why? Because their forefathers showed loyalty and allegiance to our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that small band of Muslims that were there. Even though Quraysh followed them, and you know the beautiful story when Sayyidina Maryam radiallahu anha, her story was revealed, and they equated that and said that to the king, and the king refused to give those Muslims over to the Quraysh. That was the beauty. There was also the effect of the 3-year boycott against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where his personal loss, Sayyidatina Khadija radiallahu anha, and the uncle Abu Talib, they passed away. So eventually, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was urged to leave and migrate to Madinatul Munawwara. So for 10 years, no fighting took place, no jihad took place. The Muslims were prohibited in fighting openly with the kuffar. And eventually, the time came where Allah says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أذن للذين يقاتلون بأنهم ظلموا وإن الله على نصرهم لقدير. Permission to fight is given to those upon whom war is made because they are oppressed, and most surely Allah is well able to assist them. And Allah started revealing the verses of jihad. وَقَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ وَلَا تَعْتَدُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُعْتَدِينَ. And fight in the way of Allah, those who fight you, but transgress not the limits. Truly Allah likes not those who are transgressors.
وَقَتُلُوهُمْ حَيْثُ ثَقِفْتُمُوهُمْ وَأَخْرِجُوهُمْ مِنْ حَيْثُ أَخْرَجُوكُمْ.
And kill them wherever you find them, and turn them out from where they have turned you out. These were the ayat of Quran that was eventually revealed to them as a form of defense and go on an offense. One of the main reasons, of the main reason of Badr, is in Ramadan, in the second year, it was informed that Abu Sufyan was coming from a very successful trade from Syria, and he had thousands of gold dinars. Now my brothers and sisters, please imagine, our muhajir, the people that left Makkah, they left with nothing. The Prophet alayhi salatu was their belongings, their wealth, whatever they owned, they left it. And hence the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, their tactics was whenever a caravan filled with goods used to come past by Medina, especially from Quraysh, let's ambush and let's take back. And this is part of warfare, and that is what used to happen. So what happened? Abu Sufyan knew that this route he was taking was not going to be safe. So he sends a man, look how clever he is, because he's looking for support now. He sends a man back to Makkah and to go seek help. And this man, he cuts off the nose and ears of the camel, and he takes his shirt and he rips it apart. And he says, "Oh Quraysh, your goods are with Abu Sufyan, and the caravan is being stopped by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions. I cannot say what would have happened to them. Help, help." So you can see the scenario is being created of sympathy and empathy and anger. And the Quraysh eventually rallied 1,300 well-equipped soldiers and horsemen and camels to fight the Muslims. And meanwhile, Abu Sufyan changes his route, and he turns away and goes through another route out of the reach of the Muslims, in other words. But by now, the Meccans heard that Abu Sufyan took another route, but they were so determined that they want to finish Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his party, his army, small band of followers. This was now their main aim. They want to finish them off. So Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam comes and sits with the companions, and he makes mashura. He has consultation with them. The Prophet alayhi salam did not need mashura or consultation. He was a prophet of Allah, being divinely guided, being divinely instructed. But Nabi alayhi salam is teaching us that even if you are in a position of leadership, it's good to have consultation, ask. And then, but you don't ask people who are jahils. You ask people that are intelligent. And that's what Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. He consulted with them. and then worked up strategies, in other words. It so happened, the Muhajir, and that was those who traveled with the Prophet ﷺ, that left Makkah, they are called the Muhajirs, they assured Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam that they would fight along with him until their last breath. And the first one to speak was Sayyidina Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, then Umar ibn al-Khattab, and then Al-Miqdad ibn Amr radiallahu anhu got up and he said, beautiful speech. He says, oh, Ya Rasulullah, proceed where Allah directs you. For we are with you, and we will not say, as the children of Israel said to Musa alayhi salam, Idhab anta wa rabbuka faqatila inna hajuna qa'ilun. Go you and your Lord and fight, and we will stay here. This is what they used to say. Rather, we will say, Idhab anta wa rabbuka faqatila inna ma'akuma muqatilun. Go you and your Lord and fight, and we will fight along with you. And then he goes further by saying, by Allah, if you were to take Abu Bakr al-Himad, we will still fight with determination against its defender until you gained it. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam was very pleased with this response from the Muhajir. So, but you must understand, they are a small group of people. Here, Sa'ad ibn Mu'adh of the Ansar, in other words, the Ansar were those who helped receive the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he stands up and he says, Wallahi, I feel you want us to speak, Ya Rasulullah. And the Prophet said, yes. And Sa'ad says, O Prophet of Allah, we believe in you and we testify that you are the true messenger of Allah. And we bear witness what you have given us is the truth. We give you our firm pledge of obedience and sacrifice. We will obey you most willingly in whatever you command us. And by Allah, who has sent you with truth, if you ask us to cross this Red Sea, we will do that most readily, and not a man of us will stay behind. We hope that Allah will show you through our hands those deeds of courage which will please your eyes. Kindly lead us in the battlefield in the name of Allah. Subhanallah. Of course, do you think those kind of words would be spoken in the opposite camp? Look what shaitan does. Iblis, who hates Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So shaitan, as you know, he's from the jinn. He takes he makes himself look like Surata ibn Malik. And he made the evil action of fighting Muslims to be fair, and he encourages them. No, come on, fight. What you are fighting for is the truth, says Iblis. وَإِذْ زَيَّنَ لَهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ أَعْمَالَهُمْ وَقَالَ لَا غَالِبَ لَكُمُ الْيَوْمِ مِنَ النَّاسِ وَإِنِّي جَارٌ لَكُمْ. Look how shaitan, Allah mentions that to us. Remember, shaitan made the sinful act seem alluring to them and said, no one can overcome you this day. And surely I am your protector, I am your neighbor. This is shaitan talk. فَلَمَّا تَرَاءَتِ الْفِئَتَانِ نَقَصَ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ. But when the two parties came in sight of each other, he turned upon his heels, says Allah. And he's a coward. He said, you go along, I'm behind you. Bismillah, I get after you. This is shaitan. For Allah says, shaitan's promises, يَعِدُهُمْ وَيُمَنِّيهِمْ وَمَا يَعِدُهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ إِلَّا غُرُورًا. Shaitan makes promises to them, and he arouses in them false desires, and shaitan's promises are nothing but deception. So here, we find the ill-equipped army of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, and the strong army of Quraysh. Nabi alayhi salam, 313 people. Estimate 317, there are figures, but that is the numbers we are talking about. Quraysh, 1300, well equipped. But the Muslims had, وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. Whoever puts his trust in Allah, then surely Allah is mighty and wise. It so happened before the Muslims arrived at the Badr, at the well of Badr, Quraysh came there before them. And they took the vantage position, a very clever position, because they were there first. And Ibn Abbas says so beautifully, because now the Muslims are caught, they're in the sandy position, they are behind now. He says, Ibn Abbas says, radiallahu anhu, Muslims are weak and shaitan casts frustration into their hearts. He whispered to them, this is shaitan. He whispers to us. You claim, says shaitan, that you are Allah's supporters and that his messenger is among you. However, the disbelievers have taken over the water resource from you and you need water to make wudu. This is how shaitan works. And look how beautifully Allah says, وَيُنَزِّلُ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً لِيُطَهِّرَكُمْ بِهِ وَيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمْ رِجْشَ الشَّيْطَانِ وَلِيَرْبِتَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ وَيُثَبِّتَ بِهِ الْأَقْدَامِ. Remember, says Allah, He sent down upon you from the sky rain by which to purify you and remove from you the evil suggestions of shaitan, and to make you steadfast your heart and plant firmly your feet. So what happened? When it rained, the soft sand became hard for the Muslims and they could walk on it and they could get towards the enemy, in other words. Then, this was a ni'mah which Allah sent. Another ni'mah Allah sent, because of they were scared, Allah sent a calmness over them. You know, when you, in a state of nerves, you take some kind of a Prozac to calm you. Allah sent His divine Prozac to our Sahabi Kiram. Look, Allah said, "If you hashikumun nu'asa amanatan min." Remember when He caused inner calm to enfold you as an assurance from Him. Nabi alayhi salam, in the meanwhile, was making dua whole night. All the time, Nabi alayhi salam says, "Oh Allah, the proud and arrogant Quraysh are already here disobeying you and belying your messenger. Oh Allah, I'm waiting for your victory which you have promised me. I beseech you, Allah, to defeat them." Meanwhile, Abu Jahl is also making dua. Look at his type of prayer. "Oh Lord, whichever of the two parties was less kind to his relatives and brought us what we do not know, then destroy him tomorrow." And Allah responds by saying, "In tastaftihu faqad ja'akum al-fath." O disbelievers, if you ask for a judgment, now has the judgment come unto you. And the Prophet ﷺ is constantly still making dua. He says, "Allahumma in tuhlik hadhihi al-isbat al-yawm la tu'bad. Allahumma in sha'ta lam tu'bad." He says, "Oh Allah, should this group of Muslims be defeated today, you will no longer be worshipped, Ya Allah." And he stretched out his hand, says the riwayah, and he made dua until his cloak falls off his shoulders. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu picks up the cloak and puts it back onto his shoulders. And he says, "O Prophet of Allah, you have cried enough to your Lord, Hasbuk. He will surely fulfill what He has promised you." Immediately, Allah responds, "إِذْ تَسْتَغِيثُونَ رَبَّكُمْ فَاسْتَجَابَ لَكُمْ أَنِّي مُمِدُّكُمْ بِأَلْفٍ مِّنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ مُرْدِفِينَ." When you sought help of your Lord, your Allah, and He answered you by saying, "I will help you with 1,000 angels, each behind the other in succession." Ya subhanAllah. This was Allah's response. And the Nabi alayhi salam raises his head and smiles and says, "Abshir ya Aba Bakr, ata'aka nasrullah, hadha Jibreel." He says, "Oh Abu Bakr, glad tidings are there for you. Allah's victory has approached. By Allah, I can see Jibreel on his horse in the thick of a sandstorm. سَيُهْزَمُ الْجَمْعُ وَيُوَلُّونَ الدُّهُرُ." Their multitude will be put to flight and they will show their backs. Ya Allah. Jibreel alayhi salam approaches Nabi alayhi salam. He says, "Ya Rasulullah, take this handful of sand and throw it at the enemies." And the Prophet says, as he throws the sand, he says, confusion seized their faces, and a violent sandstorm comes with the mercy of Allah. And the eyes of the enemies, and this handful of sand which the Prophet threw, subhanAllah, Allah speaks, وَمَا رَمَيْتَ إِذْ رَمَيْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ رَمَى. And you did not throw when you did throw, but Allah threw. Subhanallah. What an effect. Iblis, in the meanwhile, remember he was the form of a person, Surata Ibn Malik. He's now seeing the malaikats helping the Muslims to Aruba. You know what he says? I have nothing to do with you. You go your way. Jibreel come down towards Shaitan. And this Shaitan is holding a hand of a mushrik. But when he saw Jibreel coming towards him, he let go. And he's missing. And the man asked him, he asked Shaitan, oh, but you just told us earlier on, you're our protector and you're my neighbor. Look how Jibreel answers, mentioned in the Quran. Inni ara ma la taroon. Verily, I see what you do not see. I see what you do not see. Inni akhafu Allah. I fear Allah. Wallahu shadeedul iqab. For verily, Allah is severe in punishment. As he done dukkum, klah. Gone. This is what actually happened. Inni bari'um min, says Allah. Qal, I am free from you, says Shaitan. No, he was doing something with the other. Never, I was never with you in the first place. Shaitan lights the fire. He got a wooden spoon. He stirs everything up. And that's the end of that. Also another miracle which Allah placed in the hearts of the disbelievers was fear. And he also made the disbelievers look small in number in the eyes of the believers. And then the encouragement from the malaika came. إِذْ يُوحِي رَبُّكَ إِلَى الْمَلَائِكَ أَنِّي مَعَكُمْ فَثَبِّتُوا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Your Lord inspired the angel saying, I am with you, encourage the believers. سَأُنْقِي فِي قُلُوبِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا الرَّعْبَ فَاضْرِبُوا فَوْقَ الْأَعْنَاقِ وَاضْرِبُوا مِنْهُمْ كُلَّ بَنَانٍ. I shall cast terror into the hearts of the unbelievers, and you will strike their fingers and toes, says Allah in the Quran. Many a narration speak about the appearance of malaika at Badr. And it is also reported, after the battle, the Quraysh were recognized when the angels or the malaikas killed them by the wounds over their necks and their fingers and the toes, as mentioned in the Quran. Subhanallah. Ya Allah. We also find the bravery of the Sahaba. One particular Sahaba, he says, Umar ibn al-Humam al-Ansari, he says, Ya Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is paradise equal to the extent of the heavens and the earth? And Prophet al-Islam said, yes. And the Sahabi says, excellent, excellent. The Messenger says, alayhi salam, what makes you say excellent? He says, oh Ya Rasulullah, nothing but the desire that I may be among the residents. That is my desire. And the Prophet ﷺ says, but you are already part of that community. You'll be in Jannah. And he takes out a bag of dates and he starts eating. And then he just throws it away. He says, if I were to live until I had eaten all these dates of mine, the life would have been too long. And he goes headlong into the battle of Badr, and he is eventually martyred. Subhanallah. Abu Jahl, the arch enemy of Islam, two young boys, and there's so much to talk about, subhanallah. Two young boys, they go up to Abdurrahman al-Awf radiallahu anhu. He says, uncle, show me who's Abu Jahl. And they whisper to him, and they eventually point out who's Abu Jahl. Eventually, the two of them youngsters with their swords attacked Abu Jahl, and they mortally wounded him on the verge of death. And they came to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the two youngsters. He says, Ya Rasulullah, I killed him. And the other one said, no, I killed him. The Prophet looks at his swords and he says, both are bloody. He says, you both did the damage. And eventually, Abdullah bin Mas'ud is on the verge of death not Abdullah bin Mas'ud, Abu Jahl is on the verge of death, and Abdullah bin Mas'ud is now looking at him. And he tells him, have you seen how Allah has disgraced you? And arrogant Abu Jahl, even on the verge of dying, he says, I am not disgraced. I am no more than a man killed by his own people on the battlefield. And as you know, the habit of those times was to cut off their necks. And Abu Jahl says, make sure you cut my neck off by my shoulders so I appear big. Look how arrogant. This is the arrogance. When the head was brought to the Prophet of Abu Jahl, he recited, subhanAllah, what we recite on the day of Eid. Allahu Akbar, Alhamdulillah, Illadhi sadaka wa'adahu wa nasra abdah, wa hadama al-ahzab wahdah. Allah is great. All praise is due to Allah, who has fulfilled His promise and assisted His servant and defeated the Confederates alone. So we find, dear brothers and sisters, because of time constraints, victory was for the believers. For Allah mentions, وَذْكُرُوا إِذْ أَنْتُمْ قَلِيلٌ مُسْتَدْعَفُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ تَخَافُونَ أَن يَتَخَطَّفَكُمُ النَّاسِ. And remember when you were few and were reckoned weak in the land and were afraid that men might kidnap you. فَوَاكُمْ وَأَيَّدَكُمْ بِنَصْرِهِ وَرَزَقُكُمْ مِنَ الطَّيِّبَاتِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. But He provided a safe place for you and strengthened you with His help and provided you with good things so that you might be grateful. There are various lessons to be learned, my dear brothers, from Badr. One of it is, كَمْ مِنْ فِئَةٍ قَلِيلَةٍ غَلَبَتْ فِئَةً كَثِيرَةً بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. How often, says Allah, has a small group overcome a huge, mighty host by Allah's leave? And Allah, وَاللَّهُ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. Allah is for those who are patient. So Allah is telling us, show patience, stick to the commands of Allah, and Allah will help you. No automatic. You know, it reminds me, communism was a huge force. Russia, huge force, was a world force. Where is it now? And who did the job? The Muslims of Afghanistan. I firmly believe that there was help in the divine world. But look what's happening now. Our favorite pastimes. They start fighting amongst each other. Who needs enemies? Ya Allah. We're doing a good job amongst ourselves already. Hey, now they fight again. This is kafir. This is that. What's happening? Just hold on to the road and Allah has promised us victory. وعد الله الذين آمنوا منكم وعملوا الصالحات لا يستخلفنهم في الأرض كما استخلف الذين من قبلهم. Allah has promised those among you who believe and do righteous good deeds that He will certainly grant them succession to the present rulers on earth as He granted it to those before Him. May Allah make us, Ya Allah, we need us because we at the moment so weak. And Allah go further. وَلَيُمَكِّنَنَّ لَهُمْ دِينَهُمُ الَّذِي ارْتَضَى لَهُمْ وَلِيُبَدِّلَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ خَوْفِهِمْ أَمْنًا. And He will grant them authority to practice their religion, that which He has chosen for them. And He will surely give them in exchange security after their fear. Their fear. But it's a close. And the next ayah says, يَعْبُدُونَنِي لَا يُشْرِكُونَ بِي شَيْئًا وَمَنْ كَفَرَ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. Provided they worship me. This is the proviso. And do not associate anything with me. But whosoever disbelieves after this, they are the rebellious ones. And I end off with the ayat, وَلَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِبَدَرٍ وَأَنْتُمْ أَذِلَّةٌ فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. And already had Allah given you victory at the battle of Badr, while you were few in number, then fear Allah, perhaps you will be grateful. So much to talk. The lessons, my dear brothers, of Badr at the time was so severely felt in Makkah. It was a huge, topsy-turvy moment in the history of the world, because that's why we are here today. And we must never forget the importance of Badr. and what it means to us and what those people sacrificed. Because we need more action like Badr with the current, with the way we find ourselves today. May Allah in His infinite mercy assist us in thinking and improving our Islam, our way of life, how to be of servitude to Him. And I hope and I pray that the Ramadan that we've just come out of has taught us that. Ameen ya Rabbal Alameen. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen.